trying to find a Chipotle to have a little bit of lunch. Been a total bust today so far. IKEA are opening the biggest store in the country, but they closed the old one and there's like this changeover period and they don't open until tomorrow. So I came all the way out to Burbank, no IKEA. And what I was really trying to do was get more pedals for the, not more pedals, more shelves for the pedal library and show you guys kind of how I put that in and put that together. That will have to happen on another vlog. But I was walking past this place. This is just like a back entrance where trucks kind of load and stuff. But as I was walking by, I was like, this is like the typical musician's entrance to every gig you might ever play. And it's literally where they pick up the trash. It's kind of grimy, but it's just a thought that crossed my mind thinking about every gig I've probably ever been into. So this is where I spend a lot of the day, at my desk, at my workstation here, really working. Like the bulk of the work is getting done right here. All the tour is being booked right here. All the emails are going out, coming in. The constant bing, bing, bing that you heard yesterday, that didn't stop today. But right now, I am editing some footage for VBL. That's me.
Hey, I'm Janek Gwizdala. It's VBL.
I am. It is. This is another lesson on chords. It's just another part of the day. This is, you know, we have over 500 lessons on VBL now. When I look back on it and when I think about all the filming, all the editing, all the uploading, the whole thing, makes the vlog seem kind of easy. This is day, what are we today? Day 70 today on the vlog. And I've made over 500 videos for video-based lessons. So I got a lot of catching up to do with the vlog. Vlog is a little more involved, I will say. I do go out and about, obviously, and take the camera and do all kinds of things, and the drone sometimes, all that kind of stuff. But the more I'm making movies and the more I'm cutting things together and figuring it all out, basically, the more I realize how much I love doing this. VBL was, in the beginning, I think, it was like definitely an alternative to being on the road. Like I didn't want to be on tour as much anymore. I'd just done like 300 days on the road straight, or maybe even more, 320 days on the road. It was ridiculous. And I wanted to stay home, and I was getting into Brendan Burchard and just being, you know, online marketing a little bit and entrepreneurship and just doing something with technology. And I've always been fascinated by video and cameras and, you know, cutting things and producing things and that, all that kind of stuff. So it was definitely that that got me into VBL. And it was definitely a way to make money and stay home. It was not like I didn't want to give up playing live. I never wanted to give up playing live. And I think this year, more than any other year, proves that with 120 shows of my own. But I did want to stay home more for sure. I'd been touring solidly for about 15 years at that point, and really needed to take a break. And VBL was something that helped facilitate that and turned into so many other. I learned so much from that. I studied really hard, and I did study online marketing, and I studied video production and lighting and cameras and all kinds of stuff. And studied teaching a little bit as well, to be personable, to have lessons that were creative, to have lessons that were compelling, and to have something that people actually wanted to use and that was useful to them. And that's still happening today, which is awesome. That's what I'm editing right now, for instance, and what I do edit every week for the members, of course. But now it's become so much more. There's the YouTube thing running with the vlog. There's the touring under my own name. There's the making albums. There are the books. There are the video. There's so many different things. And all of that stuff happens right here. It's not pretty. It is sometimes not a lot of fun because it's a lot of grunt work, it's a lot of legwork. And the whole online thing and being present and communicating with the fans, it was never about making millions of dollars. I think that's really important, that if that becomes the focus, if that's why you do it, it becomes a little disingenuous, I think. You know, I was inspired to do the vlog, for instance, by Casey Neistat. You know, I checked out his vlogs and it was super compelling, and he's an amazing storyteller. He's a great filmmaker, and I've been studying him and his style of filmmaking for, I don't know, the past 6 months or so. I've been watching him, and he stopped his vlog, I think, the week I started mine. I didn't even know he had ended it, because I didn't know enough about him at the time when I'd started my vlog. But he actually, I think he stopped it like right around my birthday in November or something. And I think that's, I started maybe a week later or so. I didn't get into it because he sold his company for $20 million or something to CNN or any of the things he's achieved, the HBO thing or any of that stuff. I got into it because I think filmmaking is really fun. I think storytelling is really fun. I like it when people tell great stories. I like watching Casey Neistat's vlog, for instance. I like watching other vlogs as well. you know, my buddy Bob Reynolds does some super funny stuff and fun stuff and informative stuff. And it's, you know, I think he's in the, a little bit in the Casey Neistat vein as well. Although he pointed out that he's been making movies since he was a kid. Like, he has footage of that stuff, like literally storyboarding stuff and making movies and telling stories. And now that I've started going back through my footage and my archives of video stuff, I've realized I've been doing this since the first week I got a video camera in 2001, this little Canon camcorder that I spent probably a week's wages on this tour I was doing in Europe. And I've been making little movies since then. It's been great finding all that footage. I am gonna start to leak a little bit of that and tell some stories from the past and past tours on the vlog for sure. I can't wait to do that. That's gonna be a lot of fun. It's also a lot of work. Things are in crazy formats, some things are on tape, some things, it's gonna take time to get that footage to the point where it's malleable and I can present it to you guys on YouTube. It will not be HD, most of it, the old stuff. But it did tell me that, A, I was absolutely no doubt super inspired by Casey to do the vlog now, and it's just so much fun. It's a huge motivator for the day, knowing that I have to do it because I want to do it. You know, I've set myself this goal of doing at least 1 year, 365 days in a row, and here we are, day 70, going pretty good so far. And B, it's just something I've always loved to do but didn't connect the dots for myself until I saw people like Casey Neistat vlogging and thought, oh yeah, right. They take the camera with them everywhere they go and they make little stories about things that are happening in their life. It's just, Casey was the genius who kind of came up with the idea of posting it every single day and being consistent and growing his audience and, you know, taking all these people on a journey. I'd completely missed that. Probably the most essential and important part of it all. I've been gathering and even cutting some stuff together. I have like full movies made that, you know, I've never released and never uploaded before. I just never put two and two together to click the upload button, which I am very happy that I'm doing that now. Super happy that we have this interaction as well. The comments have been just exploding below the videos. Quick side note, what is up, YouTube, with comments in review? I have seen so many comments in review. The little blue bar that comes up underneath my video, it says there are comments in the review because they could be spam. I click on that link, I go inside. They're not spam, they're from you guys. They're great comments, and there's nothing in the right-hand column to approve them. The only option I have is to flag them or trash them. Now, that didn't used to be the case. This is something very recent. Now, has anyone else experienced this on their channel? Does anyone else have a solution for this? I've been kind of scouring around and Googling and trying to find a solution for this problem, but nobody seems to have an answer for it. Maybe it's something that's so new there isn't an answer for it yet, but comments that need approving that are held as potential spam, if anyone knows what's up with that, I would love to know, because I want to make sure those comments get made public. They are great comments. Some of them are obviously spam, and I don't want to have the spam on the page, so I do delete those. But there are a ton of comments that are not getting posted underneath the videos that I think are very important in terms of discussion, and I would like to fix that. If anyone knows how, please let me know. I'm going to get back to editing this VBL video and get it uploaded for the members, and then I have to practice. Really got to concentrate on making sure I'm not starting to practice at 12:45 in the morning. It's a lot earlier today. It's only 6:30 in the evening. And I got to start making sure it's really consistent leading up to the beginning of the tour. That is a big goal right now. Consistent practice leading up to the start of the Last Minute World Tour. Okay, I can't do a full Q&A today as much as I would like to, because there are just dozens of questions mounting up. But I did notice a bunch of questions and comments about my practice routine. And is it focused? Is it on a specific thing? Do I spend a certain amount of minutes every day doing one thing and then another? Okay, so it changes all the time. The quickest way to answer that question, and I'm gonna go into a little more detail, but the quickest way to answer that question is that it's never the same. It's always changing. Now, that's not to say that it doesn't become focused on certain things when there are certain tasks at hand. And right now the task is Last Minute World Tour. I wanna be really fundamentally sound in terms of my basic technique. Plus, I want to have my repertoire readily available. I want it to be at my fingertips and just be on demand. Now, a few weeks into the tour, that's not even going to be an issue, but I haven't been playing concerts for a really long time, for several months. So what I need to do to prepare to get on the road initially is to really work the repertoire. So I'm playing some of the tunes. You know, I've made a few notes in terms of the set list. I want to include Nas. And I don't want a situation that happened in Norway a few months ago where I couldn't remember, what was it, Norway? I don't know where it was, where I couldn't remember the chord changes on the bridge to Erdnars. Now I remember them. Hopefully I will never forget them ever again, because that was kind of a tough moment. But little things like that. I wanted to be really, really free-flowing and fluent and natural. So to that end, a certain amount of my practice routine every day now is definitely focused on fundamentals. I will be running certain exercises, just kind of stamina maintenance. And if there's something new that I come up with in terms of an exercise, I'll run it with the metronome. I pretty much always do that in the beginning, like initially for a new exercise. And I'll run some of the old ones. I'll basically use most of the exercises in All the Good Stuff just to keep my fingers moving and really, you know, lay the foundation for my fundamentals and my basic technique being totally solid for when I go out there. Because this is a really important part of what I'm doing with the world tour and the solo concert concept. What I don't want to do, and as much as I'm actually going to have to listen to previous shows because I want to edit some of them, I want to release some of them, so I will have to listen to them. What I don't want to do is be listening to those shows or previous performances anywhere close to the next show. That's gonna be very tough when I'm gigging every single night and I'm having to edit on the move. But it, just as long as my general concept is to stay away from previous shows and not to try and get back to that place that I was, especially if it was great. You know, if I have a really great night in like Syracuse, New York coming up in a few weeks, and then I get to Boston the next day and I'm desperately trying to get back to what I was doing in Syracuse because it was so great, the Boston gig is going to really suffer because there's no way I'll get back there the same way I remember it. It's far better, far more productive, and I'll give myself a far better chance of success if I go forwards into the unknown searching for something new rather than trying to get back into something and cling to something from the past. So when I practice basic technique and kind of rudimentary things, if you like, the reason I'm doing that is so that I have this solid foundation on which to build something new, so that when I'm having this crazy musical idea in my head, then my technique, my fundamental technique, isn't going to let me down when I try to express that through the music. So that's where all this stuff comes in, as technical as it might be and as kind of exercise based as this book is, and you know, and sequential and all of those things that the those exercises are in that book. That's actually really important. I'm not trying to play a concert of those exercises. Those just facilitate my basic technique and my foundation for when I go and improvise and search for something new. So that's a fundamentally important concept of the entire world tour and of playing solo and really trying to search for new things and not cling to moments in the past, as good as they might have been. And so it will go for at least a couple of hours now. It's 7 o'clock. It's not 12:45 in the morning. So today I'm kind of winning in terms of my time management and in terms of being able to get this stuff kind of happening and into my routine before I'm like in a coma and ready to fall asleep. So this will now continue for a couple of hours, and then it will change. It will morph from the fundamental things through the kind of repertoire practice, because I want to make sure I have all of my compositions at my fingertips, like I said before. And then it will just morph into exploration. And I try, you know, right now I'm a few weeks out from the tour, so I will kind of go deep into building loops and compositions and new ideas. But the closer I get to the tour, the less I'll do of that in my practice routine, because I really want to save those great moments and those discoveries for the stage and for the audience and for the tour. So I am definitely aware of what's going on in what I'm practicing. I'm definitely aware of the timeline, and I do manage my practice sessions according to what I have coming up. You know, this year I'm very fortunate that I'm touring pretty much exclusively for myself and playing my own music and my improvising on my own. So that's a first for me, to spend an entire year, an entire touring season on the road doing my own thing. And that's a great thing to be able to prepare for. Very different, but very exciting. And that is exactly what I need to get back to working on right now. So today's vlog is done. Don't forget to check tour dates in the links below. There are a ton of links in the description of this video, one of which is the tour schedule for the Last Minute World Tour. And every time I get a confirmed date, it goes on there. So make sure you check it out and see if I'm coming to a city near you or perhaps your city. And again, you can get all the good stuff. Check out my practice routine a little bit. That's all linked below. Everything is linked below. You don't have to listen to me talk about it. You can check those links out on your own time. Vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow. Thank you.